A seatbelt can stop you from going into a store. A seatbelt can stop you from climbing a tree. It can stop you from flying or from rolling down a hill. A seatbelt can stop you from doing a lot of things, like crushing bones and damaging vital organs. It can even save your life. That's why we enforce seatbelt laws, to save lives. So buckle up every trip, every time. Click it or ticket. Paid for by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Hey, folks, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Laura.
Folks, I love cupcakes. I love them, love them, love them. And so does Laura. Don't you, Laura? You love cupcakes,
yummy,
right?
Yummy, yummy.
Who doesn't? Who doesn't? What could be better than watching wrestling than having a wrestling-inspired cupcake? Folks, let me tell you. Check out Turnbuckle Cupcakes for a one-of-a-kind treat or a unique gift for the wrestling fan in your life. They have everything from amazing cupcakes to one-of-a-kind crochet fandom items. They should make a Bunkhouse Bob cupcake. I'm just saying. Folks, check out Turnbuckle Cupcakes on Facebook or visit www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com.
You're listening to a man with rock star charisma, with movie star good looks. Yes, this is Joey Ryan, and you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
Maybe I ought to just change the name of the show to the Caleb Conley Show.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605 with your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
I don't sign autographs. I very, very rarely take pictures with people, but if people insist and they're nice, then I'll do that, so...
And the lovely Laura.
I am a true and total lady. I would never headbutt anybody.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is Bunkhouse Bob, and I am the co-host of this program. Joining me in just a moment, as she does each and every week, will be the other co-host of the program, Laura. Folks, this is it for us. This is our last live episode of 2016, and what better way to end 2016 than with a Best of 2016 episode. And as a really cool treat, coming up in the 8 o'clock hour, we will have the one, the only, Miss Sü Yüng will be joining us. Folks, we thank you very much for listening tonight, however you're listening to the show. If you're listening as we record this live on Blog Talk Radio, whether or not you catch us streamed afterwards on www.fnx.network, if you catch us on iTunes, if you have the iTunes podcast app on your smartphone, Android device, computer, whatever it is, if you just type in Live from the Armory up in the search bar, you can subscribe to the show, download it, all that other good stuff. We are also on Stitcher. I'm sorry, folks, I'm preoccupied. It's the last episode of the year. We're also on Stitcher. You can find us there at www.stitcher.com. Just go through the same process that you do with iTunes. You can find us there. Folks, we would encourage you to check out our friends at Turnbuckle Cupcakes. You heard the plug for them at the beginning of the show, www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com. You can find them on Facebook as well. Check out our good friends at Top Rope Belts, www.topropebelts.com. This show 100% supports hashtag Project Kindness, and this show also supports Project Piledrive Hunger. And because I know that she has been busy all the day long, baking Christmas cookies, making homemade wreaths, staring, gazing out the window, with nothing better to do than to come on and do this show as the last part of her day, I would like to welcome to this program the other co-host, the lovely Laura.
I don't know what Christmas tree you're smoking, but this girl works all day.
Come on now.
Come on now, what? I gotta work.
You gotta work?
Yeah.
Were you working 9 to 5? What a way to make a living.
Exactly.
Yeah. How are you tonight?
Yeah. Tired. I'm very tired, but we've got a great show that's going to be on. We've got a lot to talk about. Sü Yüng's going to be on. So looking forward to talking to her. Lots of stuff has happened in the world of professional wrestling, Bob, since last we spoke.
Big week. And did you get my memo?
No.
Well, you said that we were, you know, the show was going to be on. The memo is this: the show's on right now. We're on now.
Thanks, Bob, I think.
Oh, my gosh. Don't derail this program before we even get started.
Like, I haven't done anything!
All right, well, why don't you give out the social media info, and we'll get rolling along, because we've got a lot of stuff to talk about, a cast of thousands, and a bunch of people to talk to before we call it a year.
Yes, we do. I am live tweeting tonight at From the Armory, the show's official Twitter account. You can also tweet along with me in my everyday life at Circle Sky. You can follow the shenanigans of the greatest wrestling mind of the 21st century at Bob_Delph. Our good friend George Cole, you can follow him at Heel Heat. You can find us on Facebook. The official Live from the Armory page is at facebook.com/live.armory.9. You can find us on Facebook also at Fans from Live from the Armory. You can type in that in the search bar, find us. It's a closed group, but we do let respectful people in. You can find us on YouTube, Live from the Armory, and there's our YouTube channel. We've got some stuff up there, and in 2017, it's one of our goals to get more up. So, and you can follow me on Instagram at CircleSky68.
You can also Google Sleepy Time Tea, which Laura doesn't need, because I know that immediately after this show, that noise that you hear is Laura sawing logs all the way from West Virginia.
Live in West Virginia.
What?
I don't live in West Virginia.
Close enough. We're in proximity.
Close enough, my ass. I do not live in West Virginia.
Well, Virginia, West Virginia, it's all the same.
No, it is not.
Well, it is, technically. The question really is, have you been good enough for Santa to make that magical run past the old homestead there, right down the road from the coal miner's daughter shack?
I've already told Santa that you need a sock full of coal and a sock full of switches.
I'm not talking about me. I already know what I'm getting.
I have been a very good girl this year.
Yeah.
You just ask anybody, they'll tell you.
Yeah. You know what we should have done is that I should have had Chris Riddle call into the show, and he could have sang Christmas carols in the background as background ambiance music.
He could have. That is unfortunate that we were not with the forethought of doing that. We didn't have the forethought.
Yeah, that's true. last minute on the fly. That's how we do things.
Yeah. But you know what? There's always next year. You know, there's always tomorrow for dreams that don't come true.
That's true. That is true. What did you see this week? What caught your eye in the comings and goings in the world of professional wrestling?
Well, lots of things. For one, lots of our former show guests were making names. And there was one issue that came up that I want to talk about that didn't make the show log, but let's talk about first Chris Hero being signed again to the WWE. Now, we're not sure in what capacity that he's going to be signed, because it is up in the air. Is he going to be signed as on-air talent, or is he going to be signed as a trainer? I mean, these are questions that, you know, we don't know the answers to yet.
That's true. And one of the things that caught my attention when I saw that clip come through, if I am not mistaken, and I'll bring, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to bring the co-executive producer of this program on so that he can spot fact check me, you know, almost like what they did during the debates. We're going to bring on Mr. George International Coles. George, are you there, sir?
I am, Bob. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can. Am I not mistaken, Mr. Coles, that Mr. Hero is 37 years old?
You are quite correct. He is 37. And Laura, to clear it up, the newest rumor, or you know how that goes, the scuttlebutt, is he will be a wrestler on a NXT wrestling, as some of the main stars in NXT are either going to be called up between now and the day after WrestleMania.
Oh, wow.
So they're losing some star power. Chris Hero is a name that a lot of independent fans, a lot of NXT fans know and love. So they're bringing someone in to replace some of that power that's going to go up to the main roster.
What I think I find most interesting about this is that he is one of the first, if not the first, big name, independent wrestling name, to have been signed to a developmental deal, released. And I'm talking about within reasonable time frame. There's been others that have been signed to contracts and then released and come back. But we're talking about the NXT machine that had been signed, released, and is now subsequently coming back. I find that interesting.
Well, I know there was no hard feelings on either end. They both sides understood Chris Hero is not what the WWE wanted at that time. And Chris Hero did not want to be in the WWE at that time if they didn't want his style. Now, we're talking just 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago now, but the mood and the style has changed that rapidly. Or the style that Chris Hero employs is now what you're seeing on SmackDown on Tuesday night and Raw on Monday nights.
Yeah, ring style. There is a shift in ring styles, that's for sure. Laura, what else did you see?
Well, let's also talk about my good friend Savannah Evans as the new AWA Women's Champ.
Congratulations to Miss Evans, for sure, on that accolade. Saw the picture of that. Very cool.
So proud of her. You know, I remember sitting at PWX with her and just giving people hell. And it's great to see her living her dream. And she's improving. Every time I see her, she gets better. So, yeah, we have to give congratulations, kudos, acclimates, whatever, to Miss Savannah. And we need to get her back on the show. Because when we had her on the first time, it was right at the beginning of her wrestling career, and she's done a lot since then.
That's true. So perhaps we'll see her again in 2017.
No.
I'm sure. And I do apologize. I have looked everywhere to try to find the name of this new tag team that Billy Brash and Josh Cutshaw have formed with Coach Mikey as their manager, which he's not Coach Mikey. I believe he's the creator Mikey. I'm looking forward to seeing this tag team in person. I think they did very well. I think it was at Firestar? I just saw a brief glimpse of it, and I've been looking to try to find out, you know, what the name of the tag team is and who, you know, where they were. I just cannot find it, unfortunately. But,
well, why don't you send out a tweet to Coach Mikey or to Josh? I know Josh is proactive on social media for the most part. Billy's hit and miss, so send him out a tweet and ask him, what's the name of the tag team? See what they got going on.
It's great to see, you know, Billy Brash back into wrestling because he took a little time off. And Josh Cutshaw has been improving by leaps and bounds every time I've seen him. So it's going to be interesting to see how far this duo and with their new manager go. Perhaps they'll give Mr. Tommy Thomas a run for his money.
Perhaps so. We'd be remiss if we didn't mention that Mr. Thomas won back-to-back, won again the Manager of the Year award for 2016 for the
Pro Wrestling Awards. Yeah.
Sure, yeah. So certainly want to send out congratulations to former show guest Tommy Thomas. Getting back to the tag team, I've always liked Josh Cutshaw's look. I think that he has a good look. I think he has good ring presence. And I think it's just a question of matches. He needs to get as many matches in. Maybe that's what he'll set one of his goals at in 2017, wrestling as many shows as he possibly can. So I think that'd be a good thing for him.
I think, you know, we've talked about this with a lot of people. It is just a matter of being in front of the right eyes.
Yeah.
You know?
Got to get him in that car. Got to get him rolling down the highway.
Yes, certainly, certainly. And looking forward to seeing where all that goes. And real quick, I did want to mention this because George South is a dear friend of mine, and the Power, I know at least two members of the Power very well, but there's been some backlash of a couple of them posting not their WWE checks per se, but just the envelopes that they came in.
Right, showing that they received an envelope from a Stamford, Connecticut address from WWE,
in their
you know,
name.
Incorporated. Sure. I get weekly checks from the WWE, but I just don't post them.
Right.
If I did, I'd be posting them. You're damn right I would. Why wouldn't I?
Yeah, why wouldn't anybody, for the love of Pete? And somebody was had messaged George, obviously, and had, you know, said, you know, they need to take those down. They're not ever going to use them again. WWE doesn't give a shit that they have put that up. They don't care.
No. Everybody calls it out on social media anyway. They take screenshots of stuff and says, look who I saw on Raw. And they tag WWE in the tweet or whatever. You don't think – we've already talked about this. People, you have to realize that there's an entire department in Stamford, Connecticut, that is dedicated to social media, an entire department that follows trends, hashtags, follows all the Twitter accounts, monitors what's going on, listen, direct feedback from the fans through social media has been on fire for them for the last 2 years. Get over it. They know what's going on. If there was an issue with it, don't you think that somebody would contact that person directly? I mean, obviously, they have their address to mail them a check. Come on, get over
yourself.
Exactly. Yeah,
and, you know, George even posted his old Crockett chest. Yeah, I think you have a Smoky Mountain one in there too. But you know what, people, be happy for this group of workers because they've worked so hard. You know, a lot of you out there that are, you know, throwing shade don't realize how hard they have worked that far. So, you know, especially with it being at Christmas time, can't you be happy for somebody who,
exactly,
you know, is just that, maybe that, just that much closer to living that dream? So, you know, I just wanted to mention that because it really bothers me because, you know, I know how hard Rahon, well, Montana, sorry, breaking crazy. I know how hard Montana
has. Why don't you just give out his address on the air, too?
Well, almost all of them did. I know how hard he's worked. I know how hard Zane Riley has worked. George South Jr., Tessa Blanchard, Kennedy Brink, the Heat Seekers. You know, perhaps if some of y'all were actually putting, you know, your energy into maybe bettering yourself, you could have been on there too. That's all we'll say.
That's fair enough. Speaking of holiday cheer, speaking of happiness and good moods, I have to bring onto the show my personal physician. I have to bring Dr. G onto the show as I give my dissertation on the things that I saw this week. Dr. G, are you there?
I am, Bob. How are you doing this evening?
I am doing well, sir. I'm doing well. The eggnog is flowing.
Yes, I could detect that as I'm imagining Laura did as well. How are you doing, Laura?
I'm doing just fine, Dr. G. How about you?
Oh, now that my grading is finished, I can relax a bit, so I'm doing much better. Thank you.
Well, some of the things that I saw this week, obviously there were a multitude of signings this week. Obviously we saw the Chris Hero bit. Mickie James signed a multi-year deal with the WWE to come back. A lot of people were extremely happy to have Mickie back. And I think what this does, I think that it helps solidify the women's division by giving a bona fide veteran there with legitimate experience to help some of these girls that may be struggling up on the main roster. Not that many of them are, but I think that it adds legitimacy to the division by having her come in and work with some of the younger talents. The other thing that it brought up was, where does this put perhaps Nick Aldis in the picture? Obviously he's Magnus. Him and Mickie are married. They have a child together. There's speculation that Nick Aldis may be coming along the way at some point in time. I guess we'll just have to wait and see about that. The other exciting thing that a lot of people were talking about, there were four women signed to developmental deals: Kimberly, Heidi Lovelace, Evie, and Nixon Newell all signed developmental deals with the WWE. A lot of people were excited about this, thinking that there are a few ladies that are probably either going to be either retiring or moving on after WrestleMania. Some will probably be future endeavored, but they've done quite a few call-ups, and I'm sure that you're going to see more. So thoughts, Laura, on all these signings?
Well, I'm not real familiar with the other two, but Heidi Lovelace and Kimberly I've seen at Chikara. They put on a hell of a match when Kimberly was the grand champion. And I've seen Heidi at Queens of Combat as well. So, yeah, I mean, that right there, I think the women's division of NXT has been depleted so much that they've got to get some people like a Mickie James, you know, like Kimberly and Heidi and the other two, which I'm sorry, I'm not that familiar with, you know, to build that back up. I'm excited. I'm very excited.
Yeah, Heidi Lovelace is one hell of an in-ring talent. I've seen her several occasions, and absolutely phenomenal worker. Wildcat Sports announced this week that they will be running events at the 2300 Arena, which you can also call, as I put on social media. You can call it the 2300 Kiss My Ass Club if you want to. It'll always be known as what, Mr. Coles?
That would be the ECW Arena.
Thank you, sir. They will be running events at the ECW Arena in South Philly in 2017. There'll be more on this announcement in the upcoming weeks. So make sure that you go and like the Wildcat Sports page and find out. I want to give huge props to Luke Hawks trying to not only move Wildcat Wrestling forward, but I don't know how much further you could move them north than the ECW Arena in South Philly. So hats off to Luke Hawks and all the people at Wildcat Sports for a tremendous year. The last thing that I saw, and perhaps Dr. G may have a little insight into this, the split personality of one son of a plumber, son of a plumber, in Cody Rhodes in his New Japan Pro Wrestling video. It would appear that Mr. Rhodes is heading to Japan as a member of the Bullet Club. Your thoughts, Mr. G?
I think that Cody Rhodes is both extremely talented and extremely intelligent, not just from growing up in the world of wrestling, but just from being an intelligent person. And I think it's a very intelligent way to get people interested in the next part of his career, rather than just continuing on as nice guy Cody Rhodes, but doing something very different, very unexpected. I think that it's going to help him a lot. I don't know that he needs to be a part of the Bullet Club, but being a member of a known quantity can certainly help him and help them as well, I think. I think given the right opportunity, he could. It's such a shame that he left WWE in a way, because he has so much to give, and I'm guessing that they will be regretting that quite a bit as they see him grow in his career.
I think that you're absolutely right, and I believe that he is already making them regret that, because if you look at his body of work since leaving, the matches that he's wrestled incredibly. He's in phenomenal shape, much better shape than what he was in the WWE. I also agree with the way that things are pacing out, using his brains and using what he learned in the business. He's not going for broke all at once. Everything's at a pace. A long time ago, I said on this very program, everything in wrestling is based on timing and purpose. He has both of those, timing and purpose. So I think big things. I just hope, my hope is that the Bullet Club does not become a watered down version of the NWO by adding in anybody underneath the sun that just decides to say, hey, I want to be a part of the Bullet Club. I don't think that's going to happen. I think this is a smart move. Expect big things from Cody in Japan in 2017 for sure. Which takes us to the back end of 2016, the best of 2016, if you will, folks. We talked on the show last week about coming up with a couple of different categories for best of 2016. We did that to the best of our ability. I think you're going to be surprised. I think you will be surprised at a couple of the answers. I haven't seen Laura's. I know Laura has seen my answers. But Laura, let's go on and shoot with you. Best male wrestler of 2016.
Well, I had a tie here, Bob.
A tie.
A tie, yeah. You know how we said about that, you know, get to use the time machine twice? So I couldn't really decide which one. And okay. Let me tell you about who I have here. The first choice is Cedric Alexander, which I think kind of is a no-brainer. Because, you know, he started out in 2016 setting the world on fire in places like PWX and AML and in CWF, you know. So, and he got signed. You know, that kind of, you know, clinches it. But the second choice I'm probably going to get a lot of flack for, but if you just hear me out, that you'll maybe, just maybe you'll agree with me. my second choice is Jake Manning. And the reason for that is that Jake Manning wasn't even wrestling much at the beginning of 2016.
Okay.
And he'd been under for life, you know. I guess
True.
He had really been wrestling for the last couple of years, just here, there, and everywhere. Comes onto the scene and beats John Skyler in one of the damnedest matches I've ever seen in my whole entire life. George South got involved. Brian Kanabroski got involved. Hell, I thought we all were going to get involved there for a little bit, but, I mean, I think Jake Manning beating John Skyler rejuvenated his career, proved that this man can carry a company and their title. So that's my two for, you know, best male.
Interesting pick. That's interesting. But I can appreciate it. I can appreciate it. George, do you have a pick for 2016 male?
I'm going to go a little thing, and I think I took the criteria a little differently, or Cedric would have definitely been in my running. I went with people that strictly didn't go to the WWE, and I picked Kenny Omega, a guy who's been a big star, but he made the jump from the juniors in New Japan to being a main event player and took over the Bullet Club pretty seamlessly from one AJ Styles, who is a very hard act to follow, in my opinion.
True. That is true. Dr. G?
I had a slightly different thought. Based on the matches I saw him wrestle against Matt Riddle, Zack Sabre Jr., I'd have to go with Anthony Henry. He seems to be having a real breakout year. The match with Zack Sabre Jr., if you look at the beginning, there's just some absolutely beautiful grappling that you don't see that level of grappling in wrestling anywhere. The match with Matt Riddle was just on the edge of your seat, breathtaking. And he's actually started to pick up the microphone and find his voice. And I think that he has a very big 2017 ahead of him. I think he's appeared in Evolve as well recently, so I think he's really on the on a fast track to being something quite amazing.
Interesting picks. My thought process on this was a very, very difficult pick for me because there are a ton of people that I could say. I mean, there are a ton. The talent level is so high right now that it's splitting hairs at some point. If we're considering TNA, Ring of Honor, New Japan, Lucha, independence based solely on the fact that they aren't WWE, it makes it difficult in more ways than one. That being said, my pick is Cedric Alexander. June 13th, 2016, it was announced that he would take part in the Cruiserweight Classic. His body of work wrestling in front of either 50 people or in front of millions is astounding. Given his work at promotions like PWX, Ring of Honor, AML, the passion, determination to lose the weight, to get into the classic, to impress the crowd, because I'm going with a 6 month or greater rule. He wasn't officially signed into the WWE until after June of this year, so it gives him 6 months. If I had to make an honorable mention pick, staying true to the format of independence, I have to say Jason Kincaid. It was really, really difficult. I actually flipped most of my answers all the way up until this morning. There are too many people that it's just too close to call. I mean, we could get into a dog chasing its tail, splitting hairs over this, you know, Pentagon Jr., Jason Kincaid, Anthony Henry, Matt Riddle, Caleb Conley. There are a ton, but my pick for 2016 is Cedric Alexander. Laura, best female wrestler.
I am going to go with, I'm going to take this as in what I have seen as improvement. And I know I might get a lot of flack on this too. It might be, you know, whatever, but I'm going to go with Savannah Evans.
Okay.
This chick, teamed with ODB You know, uh-huh. She has tore it up in the North Carolina scene, has gone down to Wildcat, has
yeah.
even gone up to New York. And
yeah.
now she, her first title, you know, this is somebody who was a fan maybe 2 years ago. Just a fan in the seat. So, you know, and I am a little biased, but I really do think she has done the most improvement this year. So that's who I go with.
So that's your, that's a combo pick, best female and most improved?
Yeah, well, I have another one for most improved, but I'm
okay,
just saying
right,
this is why I picked her because
okay.
of how, where she started out in 2016, where she's ended up.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify. George, best female.
I'm going to go with Eva Lise, mostly from her Lucha Underground work, where I don't think I've seen her have a bad match on television, plus all the indie stuff I've seen her done or do. She's so crisp and so much like a professional. She reminds me of Dean Malenko in a way, where there's not a wasted motion and there's not a bad match that I can name.
Fair enough. Dr. G?
This is difficult. I have two I can think of. In terms of how they've developed themselves over the year, I think Nicole Savoy, she has
yeah.
really come on strong this year. She's taken the Heart of Shimmer Championship over a very competitive field. She's an amazing grappler. She can do anything in the ring. She's has a great presence. She's great at putting rowdy audience members in their place.
Right.
You can see
no,
her some
know
queens of combat shows. And I'm also going to go with Sü Yüng. She has developed such a strong presence with her character, and she is so invested. If you see her wrestle live, and it obviously paid off with her winning the Queens of Combat Championship from the inaugural champion, Taylor Hendricks. So I'd have to go with the two of them. And again, it's a very, there are so many women who are just are stepping up their game so much, it's really difficult to make a choice for who's the best. But
I understand
those
that.
Are my
I
picks.
Understand that. No, that those are good picks, and I understand what you're saying. This is another one where we get down into getting into splitting hairs. I'm going to go with a second generation wrestler, and it's not who everybody thinks. My pick for 2016 Best Female Wrestler of the Year goes to Rachel Ellering. I think that if you look at her body of work and what she has accomplished in 2016, given her ring presence and who she works with and how the match has progressed, the timing, she just a consummate professional, seems to have the ability to work well with everyone. I think that Rachel Ellering is a person that you're going to need to keep on the front burner for 2017. Expect big things from Rachel Ellering. My pick for Female Wrestler of the Year 2016. Best Tag Team, Laura?
Hang on. I am trying to type here. Oh. You know, I got to go with the Ugly Ducklings.
Okay.
I have to because their meteoric rise, I saw their first match in PWX was a ladder match. And to see them the last time I saw them in PWX, which is only maybe a couple months later,
yeah.
incredible. With the addition of Coach Mikey, you know, they are the PWX Tag Team Champions right now. And the PWF six-man tag team title holders right now. So can't go wrong with Lance Lude, Rob Killjoy, and he is Rob Killjoy, by the way. And Colby Carino with, you know, Mikey, Coach Mikey. So that's my pick.
Very meteoric rise in 2016 for sure. Mr. Coles?
I'm going to go with one, and I based it off of, I think they're the biggest act in wrestling. They're currently the PWG Tag Team Champions, Ring of Honor Tag Team Champions, and IWGP junior heavyweight tag team champions, and that's the Young Bucks. How can you go against the Young Bucks? They're selling out everywhere they go. They're riddled with championships, and they're not even hit. They haven't even hit their prime yet. I mean,
fair enough.
To me,
that's the scary part.
Yeah.
I think they're getting to the point where, yeah, at one point they were spot monkeys, and they'll even admit that. But I think they're getting to the point where they've evolved their games to the point where they're some of the best wrestlers, two of the best wrestlers in the world.
Good pick. Mr. G?
I'd have to agree with Laura and go with the Ugly Ducklings. They were three guys who, you know, by their own admission, weren't really getting used to their potential. I'd seen them wrestle individually, and all three are just ridiculously talented, and they managed to come together, and as you mentioned, in professional wrestling, timing is incredibly important. They came together, and almost immediately, the fans just got behind them, and together, they're a force. So I think that if they can keep their momentum going, again, they can really break out next year and have great things ahead of them.
Certainly have a cult-like following, that's for sure. My pick for 2016 Tag Team of the Year is going to be the Carnies. That would be Nick Higgy and Kerry Offal. Given in light of the events that happened this past weekend in Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment, Roar, Women's Professional Wrestling of Atlanta, there's going to be hell to pay in Atlanta in 2017. Look for a very violent, violent feud from the Carnies and the Hierarchy out of Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment. It may even go up and down the coast, for all I know. The Carnies, Nick Higgy, Kerry Offal, my pick for 2016 Tag Team of the Year. Laura, your most improved category.
I got two.
Okay.
So I've got Mr. James Drake.
Good pick.
Who came out of nowhere and, well, not really nowhere. I've seen him wrestle a lot in other places. But came to PWX, like, you know, I got something to prove. And here I come. I'm going to wrestle Gunner. He might beat the shit out of me, which he didn't. But it was a great match. The first match was absolutely wonderful. I didn't get to see the second one. And he's, you know, I mean, just in-freaking-credible. Proud of James Drake, who is the current PWX ITV champ who beat Gunner for that belt. The second pick is Mr. Darius Lockhart.
Okay.
You know, stellar 2016, and at the end of 2016 ends up as the newest member of the Revolt, which I think puts a whole new spin on Revolt. It's going to be really interesting to see what Caleb, Zane, and Darius do in PWX in 2016, I think PWX may not be left standing by the time it's over in 2017.
That's quite possible. Mr. Coles?
You know, I originally had a different thought, but Laura's second pick, Darius Lockhart, is who I'm going to go with as well. For a man done this year and how much he's improved, it really seems like he's figured it out, and it's clicking for him. It's only a matter of time before he's one of the guys that's headlining almost every show you see him on.
Dr. G?
I'm going to have to go with Savannah Evans. I remember seeing her first match in Queens of Combat, which wasn't that long ago, and she's come so far since then. And having the opportunity to talk with her after some shows, she really gets it. I mean, I'm a bit biased in this. She's also a fellow psychologist. She has a degree in psychology, and she seems to be putting it to good use. But with her worth ethic and just her mind for the business and her desire to learn and how far she's come already, she's my pick for most improved, and I think she's going to improve even more in 2017. Looking forward to see where she is by this time next year.
That's a fair statement. my pick for most improved, you know, they call Kelly Klein the gatekeeper at Women of Honor, but she's not my pick. My pick for most improved wrestler of 2016 has to be Kennedy Brink. Going to Florida, going to the Team 3D Academy, and having had the opportunity to watch her wrestle on several different levels, both at Wildcat shows, Queens of Combat, Women of Honor, it is plain to see that she is on a rise like none other. I expect big things out of Kennedy Brink in 2017, so keep an eye out for Kennedy. Lori, your biggest disappointment of 2016?
Would have to be Ring of Honor letting all these great people go.
Good Lord.
I mean, let's start out with the most obvious, Cedric Alexander. Kevin Owens, Sting, whatever, taps him as, this is the guy that needs to, you know, carry the torch forward.
Right.
And what do you do with him? You stick him with Veda Scott.
Yeah.
In a dumb angle. I never did figure out what that was all about. Moose, we've said it before on the show, looks much more at home at TNA than he ever did in Ring of Honor. Moose actually looks like he belongs in TNA. Ring of Honor, there was just something not right with that.
Yeah. I think that's fair.
Something not right. And, you know, you have to, even though the same thing with Cedric, you know, I mean, I don't think this is on the same lines as Cedric, I should say. Steve Corino. You know, I'm happy for everybody, don't get me wrong. But I am sure going to miss Steve Corino on Ring of Honor. We'll miss seeing him around the Carolinas. But that had to be such a blow to let someone who's been the backbone of Ring of Honor for many years go.
That's true. There's things shaking up at Ring of Honor, that's for sure. I can understand why you'd say that. Mr. Coles?
Mine's a very similar issue, and it would be Ring of Honor's inability to create new stars. In the past, we've had mass exodus before. We've had Tyler Blackley, Brian Danielson, Nigel McGuinness, Samoa Joe, CM Punk. But they always had someone there ready to take their spot. And for me, it seems like there's a logjam at the top of Ring of Honor with your Adam Coles, your Kyle O'Reillys, your Jay Lethals. Then you got the New Japan guys. And then you got the guys that they should be developing to take the spots of these guys as they move on, as a Moose moves on, as a Cedric Alexander moves on. They should be having someone ready in the wings waiting, which was always what kept Ring of Honor going. When Tyler Black left, Kevin Steen stepped up. When Brian Danielson left, Tyler Black stepped up. When Samoa Joe left, Brian Danielson stepped up, and so on and so forth. And to me, it's been their biggest problem is their inability to grow a next generation of star, and coupled with leaning too heavily on New Japan for talent.
Makes sense. Dr. G?
I'm going to go with TNA casting Caleb Conley as the Invisible Man.
Yes!
Anyone who has followed his career in PWX wrestling has seen him have some absolutely spectacular matches with anyone and everyone he's wrestled. Some of the matches with Cedric Alexander, just the way they told such interesting stories and were able to make just little things really important. He's just another one where they signed him, and if they gave him an opportunity, he could steal the show every night and help them, help other wrestlers seem more important. So it's a little frustrating to see that. Again, maybe that's not on the level as what Laura and George mentioned, but it's still a pretty big disappointment.
It sure is, Dr. G. It sure is. My BFF needs to be on TV every week.
Every week, I know. We got it. Biggest disappointment for me is also a promotion, but it's not Ring of Honor. My biggest disappointment in 2016 has to be Global Force Wrestling. Touted as the next big thing to come down the pipe, despite the successful baseball stadium shows in certain markets. After that, Global Force Wrestling kind of went silent. They had a few shows, but a large majority of their promotional deal through 2016 was Jeff Jarrett and Karen Jarrett and Sanjay Dutt doing autograph signings. There were rumors of television deals, you know, shopping pilots around. And for the most part, in the back half of 2016, it just kind of fell flat for me. I don't really know if you go to the website, there's still the same stuff that's up. So for me, with all of the talent that Jeff Jarrett initially had drawn towards Global Force, it just seems like there's no force there at all. So that's my biggest disappointment of 2016. Last category, and we got to roll on because we've got a guest coming up here in about 10 minutes. Sü Yüng will be joining us here in the 8 o'clock hour, folks. Match of the year, Laura. What was your match of the year?
I got three of them. One is Jason Kincaid versus Pentagon Jr. The other one is the Lucha match at the WrestleCade. And the third and final match of the year is the Revolt versus the Experience in War Games.
That's pretty good. Those are all three solid ones. You couldn't settle on just one, though.
I couldn't, Bob. You know how I am. I can't decide.
Oh, Lord. Mr. Coles, your match of the year for 2016?
Well, because I can color within the lines, I'm going to go with one match, and that's the War Games match, Revolt versus the Experience. I thought it was excellent.
Fair. You can color within the lines. That's
boring.
That is good to know, Mr. Coles. Dr. G, your match of the year?
I saw the War Games match live. It was absolutely wonderful storytelling, excellent match. But I think I might have to go with the final match of this year's PWX X16 tournament and Ethan Case versus Anthony Henry. Just such an edge of your seat story, kind of almost the passing of the torch. Very emotional match, very physical match, and a great story as well. One of my favorites.
Very cool. You know, they're all standout matches. Everyone that everybody mentioned, and there are several that came to my mind. Ricochet and Will Ospreay from WrestleMania weekend at Evolve. Shibata, any of Shibata's matches now, I'm thoroughly in love with. But for me, we have to go back to the beginning of the year at Wrestle Kingdom, the IWGP heavyweight title match, Kazuchika Okada versus Hiroshi Tanahashi. For me, that match on one of the biggest platforms, a lot of story, a lot of history behind that, Tanahashi's record at the Tokyo Dome, all that stuff just played into a five-star match for me. So that's my pick, would be Okada versus Tanahashi from Wrestle Kingdom. So that's the one that got me.
Whew. I'm still behind on tweeting.
Well, I guess you'll have to catch up at some point. Mr. Coles, obviously 2016 for us will be in the record books because this is our last live episode of 2016. Obviously, want to thank you very much for your contributions in 2016, helping fill in, fact-checking, doing all that is you do, coloring within the lines, all that good stuff. So thank you very much, George.
Not a problem, guys. Have a great holiday season. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year's to you.
Same to you, Mr. Coles. Thank you, sir. Dr. G?
Yes, Bob?
We'd certainly like to thank you for your contributions in 2016. I know that from a personal standpoint, that I know that that my mental well-being is much more on a stable platform than it ever has been because of your good work, sir.
Thank you, Bob. I'm just glad I was able to help you find your way a little bit better. You wouldn't have done that if you weren't a good person, a solid person to begin with. And I'm sure that, let me rephrase that. I'm just glad I was able to be a part of the show. I'm glad that you both invited me, and anytime I can contribute anything, I'll be here. Just let me know.
Absolutely. Thank
and
you
I hope
very
you
much,
have a
Dr.
wonderful holiday.
You do the same,
Thank
sir.
You,
have
Dr.
a great
G,
holiday.
You too.
Happy New Year to you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Happy holidays.
And there goes Dr. G. So that's our best of 2016 portion. What'd you think, Laura? You happy with everything? Everything turned out all right?
I think so. You know, we are all different people, and I like to hear what other people find to be the best in their opinion. And, you know, I like to talk about that and share it. And
sure.
Some great stuff. We had some great
Absolutely.
Stuff. I'm probably going to need you to tell me what your match of the year was again, because I don't remember it.
IWGP Heavyweight Championship match, Okada and Tanahashi at Wrestle Kingdom was mine. And that's how that goes.
Okay.
You can tweet that out later. I know that's a lot of characters to get out. What I need you to do, I need you to go on and read down the indie events, and I'll be back in just a couple of minutes, okay?
Okay. Indie events for this weekend, folks. We've got the House of Hardcore 22, Friday, December 16th at the 2300 Arena in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We have another House of Hardcore. It's House of Hardcore 23 the next night. It's Saturday, December 17th at the MCW Arena in Joppa, Maryland. Both events are available on Flow Slam. You can visit www.houseofhardcore.net for more information. CWF presents Cruise Center Clash, Saturday, December 17th at the Cruise Road Rec Center in Matthews, North Carolina. John will be flying solo Saturday night for this one. You can find out more by visiting www.cwf247.com. ECCW has a benefit show called Wrestling with Hunger to benefit Share Family Services. Please bring non-perishable food, toys, blankets, or warm clothes. Saturday, December 17th at the Hall number 49 at Port Coquitlam, British Columbia. You can find out more information by visiting www.eccw.com. Big time.
I'm sorry, the person you are trying to reach has a voicemail box that has not been set up yet. Please try your call again later.
What was that? Maybe I'm the only one that heard it. Moving right along. Big Time Wrestling Carolinas presents Seasons Beatings, Sunday, December 18th at the Davie County High School in Moxville, North Carolina. There's information on Facebook. Just search Big Time Wrestling Carolina. PWX presents Seasons Deleting, Sunday, December 18th at the Cabarrus Arena in Concord, North Carolina. It's going to be available on Flow Slam. You can visit www.pwxpro.com. Our good friend, Broken Matt Hardy, is going to be there. If you're going to be in the Concord, North Carolina area, and you have not seen Broken Matt Hardy live and in color, I suggest you go out and do so. It is the best thing ever. God bless Matt Hardy. I'm not sure where old Bunkhouse Bob is, but I'm just going to talk a little bit about Tag Team Apocalypto tomorrow night. I better see Caleb Conley on that show. I'm just saying. Or I might have to take a drive out to Nashville and bite on Dixie's front door and say, where the hell's Caleb Conley? Now, this is ridiculous. You signed him almost a year ago. What the heck, Dixie? Come on now. I'm going to get Chris Riddle on here and make fun of you a little bit till we can get Caleb on here. Bob. Bob, are you there? I'm a little nervous about whatever it was I heard, making sure that, you know, it wasn't something that went wrong with the show. Dead air, folks. I hope it's just dead air. It's not.
What's anything. Dead air? You just sitting there talking to yourself?
Yeah, I'm talking to myself.
Well, I told you I'd be back in a couple of minutes, folks. I'm trying to get Sü Yüng on the phone right now, and you're just going to have to bear with me. I'm going to give her like 2 minutes, Laura, and try it again.
Okay.
But we'll just we'll carry on for a second and see what happens. I'm not sure what's going on, but we'll give it a try here again in just a minute. It's not a big deal. So what were you rambling on about?
I was rambling on about the tag team Apocalypto.
Ah, yes, yes.
It's going to be good because I just saw on Facebook today where the Bravados got their invite. And, you know, Grandma's already wanting to know, do they need to bring a covered dish? Because good Southern boys, that's what they do when they're invited someplace, bring a covered dish. I really can't wait for this thing. I really and truly can't. I'm so excited for it.
Yeah,
and,
I am too. And there's a lot of people that are excited for it. I'm sorry, folks. I'm trying to text and call and do a bunch of stuff all at the same time. So, no, did you see that little bit that I shared from on Twitter with the CBS weather guy?
John played it for me over the phone. Yes. Oh, my goodness. Oh, deleting.
Yeah, what do you call it? The chance of deletion was high.
Yes.
Yeah, very cool stuff. Very cool stuff. Sent that off there, and we'll carry on here for a minute. So, at any rate, best of 2016 stuff. Obviously, there are several people that we want to thank, and you know, we do this show live without a doubt, folks. We always have. We always continue to. That's just the way that we do it. All wrestling events are live, and the show always has to go on, and that's what we do. There are several people, and I think that we thanked them a little bit last week, but obviously want to thank George, want to thank Dr. G, want to thank FNX Network, want to thank Turnbuckle Cupcakes, Top Rope Belts, Lala and Steve, hashtag Project Kindness, want to thank them, Ryan Oshun, with Project Piledrive Hunger, want to thank him. All those good people, want to thank all of them for all their help and support during 2016. Obviously, want to thank the listeners. You know, if we didn't do the listeners, we'd just be sitting here with dead air, you know, that kind of thing. So, you know what? It looks like we have our guest on the line. So enough of my rambling about what we did in 2016. She was there, and now it's gone again. So, hold on a second. And we're going to give it another minute. So, given everything that's happened, obviously we want to thank all of these people. They've made it great. Is there anybody that you want to thank, Laura?
Well, I'd like to thank all of our listeners for making us the premier podcast of indie wrestling. I'd like to thank you, Bob, for putting up with me. I know it's a hard job, and I promise not to be as difficult to deal with in 2017. I will try not to call the show when I am high on painkillers. Like I did when I had my gallbladder out, which if you haven't heard that show, I think it's pretty funny.
Laura, I'll be right back, okay?
Sure. There goes Bob. Would like to thank all the wrestlers that I have met who have, you know, come on and been guests. We really enjoyed talking to each and every wrestler photographer, manager, anybody that we've had on, just guests in general. I've enjoyed talking and learning. I learned something new from each guest, whether it's about life or about them or about wrestling. I look at this, like Bobby said in the past, as just a chat between friends. We're just, you know, finding new stuff out about people. I found out a lot of stuff about Bob here recently that I did not know. So it just goes to show that if you sit down and talk to people and listen, you find out all kinds of things, even things about yourself that you didn't know. But I thank George for being such a great friend, for co-hosting with me when I when Bob was gone, and for filling in for me when I was gone. I was on several shows this year due to surgery and another going to the ball game with John. So thanks to George Coles, and thanks to Dr. G for trying to set Bob straight, although I'm not quite sure that we accomplished what we'd set out, but we did make some progress.
You can't set me straight. There is nobody on the face of God's green earth that can set me straight. I would like for somebody to come set me straight. Is there anybody here that thinks that they can come set me straight? Anybody at all?
I bet Sue could.
Maybe Sü Yüng could. Can Sü Yüng set me straight?
Hello?
Hello, Sue?
Hey.
Is that you?
Yes, it is me. Hello.
How are you?
Very good. How are you?
I'm doing good. I'm doing really, really well. Thank you very much for taking time out of your busy evening to be with us tonight. We appreciate it.
Hello?
Sue, oh. Can you hear me? Sue?
Oh, God.
Oh, my gosh. And there goes her phone. We were just talking before she came on air that somebody did something to her phone at the last show that she was at, and her phone has been acting stupid ever since. So we're going to try this one more time. Let's just see if we can't do this real quick. Hold on here. Give me one second.
This is just great, isn't it, folks? It's great. Well, it's live radio. What do you expect? So, what would you guys like to talk about? I'm heading toward, you know, Caleb Conley, but that's just me, and that's the way I do. Can't wait. Are you there, Bob?
I am here. I was just listening to you. I'm trying to get Sü Yüng back on the phone. It seems that we have some type of technical difficulty on her end with her phone. I call the number, and it's going back to her voicemail again.
Voicemail.
So, yeah.
Perhaps she could get another phone.
Maybe so, perhaps. We'll see. I'm going to try it again here in another couple of minutes and see what happens. And hopefully, folks, we can get these issues resolved. And we'll get Sue on the phone just as soon as we can for you.
Well, you know, it is the way it is. And, you know, we've had issues in the past before, you know, it's the way it goes.
That's true. At the very least, I know that it's not on our end. I do know that. So,
right.
I hate to keep putting you on the spot, but give me a minute, okay?
Okie dokie. Well, you know, had I been prepared, I would have prepared, you know, notes, you know, a speech, things of that nature. But I would like to tell you that I was on the panel for the Carolina Professional Wrestling Awards this year, and it was a tough, go. We had a lot to choose from. But I think the people who, you know, won did deservedly so win. The Carolinas have just got a lot of talent right now, a lot of great promotions, and it is hard to, you know, try to pick the best of all that.
Yeah, and Sue doesn't want you to talk anymore. She says she can't wait any longer to do this interview because she's on the air with us right now. Because she can't wait. Right, Sue?
Hello.
How are you? Can you hear me?
I'm very good. How are you guys?
We're doing good. We're doing good. Listen, let's just clear the air. Let's just spread the peanut butter. It's all good. It's all cool.
I prefer smooth and chunky.
Most people do. I don't care for it. You know, it hits
no,
you with your mouth.
I think I like chunky.
You like chunky? Okay.
I think I like all peanut butter. All peanut butter.
Do you like the peanut butter that has the jelly already mixed in it?
What? What kind of atrocity is this?
Do you remember that?
I want to say Smuckers came out with them.
Yeah,
that's right. That's right. At any rate.
I don't know. I think it'd be kind of cool if you mix it with ice cream. That's all I can say.
That would be cool.
Interesting.
Folks, we're just passing the time of evening now that we have all the technical difficulties done. And we're talking with Sü Yüng. Sü, thank you so much for being with us tonight. How are you?
I'm pretty fantastic, actually. How are you guys?
We're doing well. We're doing well. Can't complain. Obviously, on the other end of the line with us is the other co-host of the program, Laura. Laura, you want to say hello to Sue?
Hey, Sue. It is great to have you on the show.
Thank you guys for having me very much. I appreciate it. This is pretty cool. I haven't done a podcast in a while, and I felt a little rushed in the way about this. So, see
cool.
how this goes.
We'll see
also,
how it goes.
Yeah.
Well, we've already talked about peanut butter, so the bulk of it's over with. Well, the rest of it's just, you know, internet fodder at this point. So we're all good.
Of course, of course.
We'll get rolling. You recently won the Queens of Combat title from Taylor Hendricks. And both Laura and I were at that event. We got to see you. And the thing that I couldn't stop thinking about was how much you two have in common as performers. I mean, if you take Taylor from 3 years ago and you from 3 years ago, we're talking about a total transformation. I mean, was the transformation into the Sü Yüng that we see today, was it out of choice or was it out of necessity, Sue?
Actually, this happened out of chance. Does that intrigue you?
Yeah, I mean, how is it that we get to this point? How does chance do that?
Sometimes in life, people look at you in moments of, you know, exploration, I guess you could say. And someone believed in me one day, and they said, hey, this is an idea I have. What do you think? And I'm not going to go into super deep details, because I have before,
right.
But I feel like it just leaves a little bit more of a mystery for everybody else to understand,
sure.
You know, hey, this could happen to me. And it can, absolutely. You know, sometimes when you get opportunities where you feel like, man, this feels so crazy. I don't know what else to do. You just take it and run with it and see what happens within your adventures. And with everybody, you get your own adventures, but within your own, it's going to be the greatest story ever told because it is your own, of course, and it's your legacy. You know what I mean?
You're right. Well, that's fair enough. That's fair enough. I mean, when I got the chance to speak with you in November, you were very personable, and you seemed interested in what I had to say. And I mean, we're a few years into this journey now. Is everything still the way that you want it to be, Sue?
Absolutely. I mean, you can't really ask much of wrestling as it, you know, presents it to you. Just kind of accept what you see and what you adapt to, and you love to learn it. Well, in a weird way, if you have passion for it, you love to learn it.
You know, you brought up an interesting word. You just mentioned passion, and I know that you've said in the past that the fans in the Memphis area were very passionate, that they were invested in wrestling like none other, and still are. another area that you were just recently in, Atlanta, had that same kind of magic at one point, but has struggled to regain it despite the work that AWE and other people were doing. Why is that, in your opinion? Why is it that an area can thrive and then just fall off the face of the map?
To be honest, there's nothing wrong with that area, in my opinion, because the people that come to the shows and the people that support and the people that love what we're doing, like, we feel that through when you guys come through and you guys support and you guys show passion for what we have. And the big thing to me is more along the lines of, it's not a what's wrong with the area, but more along the lines of, why aren't we spreading more of this around? Why aren't we spreading more love around about wrestling? Because there's a lot of people that look at wrestling in a negative light, and in my opinion, wrestling has such a positive light to it that it helps people in life. It helps people become better people because they see the struggles through the stories, and they see the struggles through the matches, and that's what makes us, you know, human and cool and special in our own way.
You know, Laura and I were talking last week about that very thing, about the fans, at least in a sense, about some that are able to spread that love and others that aren't, you know, the obnoxious smarts. Are the fans still fun for you, Sue?
Absolutely. I got Ben Martin on my side, Papa Hales. I got motherfucking, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to crush that like that, but that was like a throw out to Juan Antonio down in Miami, who had my back ever since, you know, I got released from FCW and WWE. Like, all these fans, I even have girls like Mallory over in Seattle, who's been running one of my coolest fan sites ever, and like, all these people in my life within wrestling that have been supporting me throughout this whole thing. I'm just blessed and lucky to have what I have now. And I'm blessed and lucky to be where I'm at right now within wrestling, which is a really cool spot where people, you know, I'm not trying to, like, sound like I'm bragging or anything along those lines, but it's very humbling when anyone comes up to you saying, I want to wrestle you. And that's been one of the coolest things of 2016 for me so far.
It's always cool to make that list. You know,
yeah.
We see the list on social media all the time. You know, wrestlers saying, I'd like to wrestle so-and-so. Who have you been most humbled by, Sue, that you've appeared on someone's list that just kind of struck you?
Are you joking right now?
No.
The person that's humbled me the most out of my whole career right now.
Yeah. Said, I want to wrestle you.
Oh, you mean like if they asked me, if they
yes.
said to me they wanted to wrestle me, or if I wrestled them and it humbled me?
No, vice versa, the other
okay.
way around.
Because I was about to say. I was like, that's a loaded question, but I think we all know the answer to the one that humbled me the most. But as far as the person that came up to me and was like, hey, I want to wrestle you. Like, honestly, there's no person in general. If anyone says that to me, it makes me step back and be like, wow, really? Because the idea of diversity within wrestling, and then, you know, the people, the standards of where people put people, and for me to be looked at that way, it's very, very humbling in my opinion. Just because I want to wrestle everybody in every area, everywhere. And if there was a way to do it in space, I would totally do it. Or underwater, I would totally do it. Like, any kind of way
that.
I can wrestle. I that's all I want to do is just wrestle.
All right. You mentioned a few minutes ago about FCW. Before the WWE Performance Center, before the media blitz, glamorizing NXT, John Laurinaitis and Ty Bailey are at FCW. What, I guess the term disconnected seemed to come up a lot when referring to Mr. Bailey. Looking back now, how do you describe your experience to there when people ask you about it? And how do you feel about the recent signings of, say, Heidi Lovelace and Kimberly. Is this still a destination that you would like to return to, Sue, or is that, was that just another arrival point on the map?
I hope you don't mind, but I'm going to answer this in order. My experience was magical. I would never take it away for anything in the world. I think that that place, no matter what form, has some sort of magic behind it. And it brings happiness to people. And it, you know, brings up a bunch of different feelings of dreams and desire, and that's a very influential place to be. So whenever you're in an area like that, soak it in, you know what I mean, and feel it, because there's never ever going to be a time where you feel that in the real world. Upon that, I feel amazing and happy, and you know, over the world, honestly, for any girl that gets to do anything they want with their life, if that's their dream, I'm always going to be happy for them, because I don't believe in a, like, spot or a statistic within the world. I believe everyone's their own, and within that individual, we, like, have the room to appreciate who they are and what they do. And as far as my aspirations go or inspirations go, right now, I feel lucky as it is to be wrestling where I'm at. And if my career decides to go further, like overseas or signing to any place, I let it be. I'm enjoying my life and I'm enjoying my path. And I can't say anything other than I really love wrestling right now. And I think that the wrestling world is really awesome, and there's so many amazing wrestlers out there that the world, you know, has yet to see, that when they do, their minds are going to be blown, and they're going to be so excited and happy for the rest of their lives.
Right. That's cool. That's cool. Now, I know from reading a couple of posts that you put up on social media that you're a fan of the game show Let's Make a Deal. Is that true?
Wait.
Now, now, do you like the old school version of Let's Make a Deal, or do you like the newer version? Which one do you prefer?
I can't say either or, because I just love the game itself. When I was a child, my mom loved watching what is it called? The Whammy Show.
Oh, Press Your Luck.
Yeah, Press Your Luck. And that's the thing that got me, like, super into shows like that, because I was like, oh, this is, like, really exciting. I guess, you know, kind of a similar thrill when you watch a wrestling match where you're like, oh, this is so exciting. Like, you know, it's really awesome. And it was that show that I was like, oh, I love that show, because it was so random and weird, you know? And everyone was wearing costumes.
Yeah, people would dress up and stuff. Yeah, that's kind of...
Yep.
My grandmother always enjoyed The Price is Right with Bob Barker. You know?
Oh, yes! That
the
show's
showcase
so good,
showdown.
Too.
Yeah, she was...
And then Drew Carey took it over.
Yeah,
he did
that's true.
Pretty good.
Yeah, he did pretty
good. Yeah, he was great at it. I think he was great. I always loved
family.
Drew Carey, especially when he was in Whose Line Is It Anyway? So good.
Ooh. Love Who's Line.
Well, I'm going to make it easy for you, because behind door number two is Laura. So, Laura, you win Laura for the next
That's right.
little bit.
You didn't get zonked.
Yeah. Best prize ever.
See, Sü Yüng thinks I'm the best prize ever. So, hey. You know, you talked a little bit about with Bob about, you know, the incarnation that you are now as far as a wrestler, as far as your ring attire. And I was just wondering, there's been a lot of wrestlers throughout the history of wrestling who've painted their face. And I was just wondering, did you happen to draw that inspiration to do that from, you know, the likes of Kabuki or Muda or Bull Nakano or even Sting. I'm just curious as to where, all, you know, the idea for that came from.
Oh, the mysteries, Laura. Oh, the mysteries. I don't know. You know, when people ask me loaded questions like that, I don't know whether to really answer or to write it in a book and be like, ooh, more money. But there's a part of me that's like, oh, I just got to tell you. There is a mastermind behind this character. And, you know, I think it's more of a mystery when people try and figure it out. And it's more fun that way for me anyways, for you guys to, you know, follow the story out. But there's a lot of influential things behind this character and, you know, behind the face paint and, like, within every owner, very dynamic that no one really notices. And it's really interesting when people do pick up on it because it's like, oh, I'm like an Alfred Hitchcock. Like, oh, yeah, they're picking up on it. Like, they know what I'm talking about. But at the same time, most people don't understand what I'm even saying for the most part. Like, I don't know. I guess the best way to put it, most people say I'm like a puzzle. And for you to figure it out, it's very easy to figure out. But if you figure it out, like, you're like, oh, I get it now. And then you follow the pattern, like a video game, I guess you can say. Like when you watch, when you watch from Shine 1 all the way up to the next Shines, like it's like a little, video game. You know what I'm saying?
Hmm.
Always in the beginning, you're gonna be easy. You know what I'm saying? Like
right.
Within Mario, Super Mario, yeah, Super Mario World, Hex Yeah, boom, going really easy. And then all of a sudden you're like, oh, what? What is this? And you're like underwater,
exactly.
Or like you're in like out of nowhere, just in the air, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's so many different dynamics that can happen, and it's up
true.
To the person to, you know, make it happen, the magic.
Well, it certainly is magical, and there is an air of mystery when you come out, and I was just, you know, curious, because some of your face paintings I've seen remind me of Kabuki Theater from Japan. So
absolutely. Absolutely.
So that, you know,
there's many, many, many influences or I can't even say it because I can't speak English very well. And it's my primary language. That's why I don't talk as much. But influences within the mastermind's mind work. And I'm not saying, like, he didn't take my opinions in, like, in influence or, like, when I would execute anything in my mind, I would do it. But he's always approved of a lot of things that have been going on, and he's very happy with the outcome of his imagination. Because I have taken the ball, and I took it as far as I can for the most part.
Hmm.
Or as far as I'm going. I don't know, because I never know what's going to happen in the future, so I can't predict things for you guys. I'm sorry. I can't.
Well, speaking of the future, I'm just curious as to what do you hope to achieve in your run as Queens of Combat champion?
Are you asking, like, in my wishes, or are you asking within the realms of reality? Because those are two different things. Absolutely two different things.
Well, let's take your wishes first, and then we'll talk about reality.
My wishes?
That's what I thought you said. Well, I mean,
my
do you
wishes
hope to...
within, like, the future
well, I mean,
of wrestling?
Well, yeah, I mean, what do you hope? I guess, you know, when someone talks about, you know, Sü Yüng, you know, in the future as Queens of Combat champion, what would you like for them to, you know, say, or, you know, what do you hope to achieve with the title? Which I know that kind of got really complicated with me just saying that, but, you know, go with it.
for my own wishes and my own, like, ideas of what I would love to see in 2017 as a future is more along the lines of people being influenced positively by wrestling and having great matches with girls that want the same goals as I do, which is to wrestle their hearts out and to keep wrestling a very positive place for everybody, because this place can be negative at times, and I feel like in moments of negativity, there's always moments of positivity because people prefer to look down than look up. It's easier. You know what I'm saying? Like, even as when you stand, it's easier to look down than look up. And when you look up, it makes you stronger as a person physically and mentally. And I feel like within wrestling, in moments of, like, darkness where everything seems like it's going to be bad, you know, always remember the good that has happened and remember that it is going to happen again, because within wrestling, it's a cycle, but not like a cycle as in, like, predictable cycle. It's an unpredictable roller coaster that you never know what's going to happen or what's going to go down. And when it does go down, whoa! And you should never, ever let anybody take that away from you, because moments like that are magical and special.
I totally agree. I prefer to live life in, I think there's a meme floating around the internet that says, you know, live life in the front car, and it's two older women who are in this, it's not necessarily a roller coaster, but some kind of carnival ride where they are riding this ride, and their skirts are coming up. And, you know, and they're not really doing anything to, you know, to put their skirts down. So, yeah, I would much rather ride hands up, you know, having a ball than, you know, and having a little bit of an uncertainty about things than, you know, being on the tried and true path that you know what the outcome is going to be.
It's so crazy you said that, because, like, you know, there's some people that interpret what you just said in one way or another, but I feel like everyone can associate with it, because within wrestling, anything is possible and anything can happen. And even better or worse, like, it's always going to be memorable no matter what. And it's up to, you know, everybody, including, like, because I've seen amazing wrestling in front of very greedy fans, and they don't even care, like, that these guys are putting their bodies on the line, you know what I'm saying? But then I see the most grateful fans, and I see the most, you know, I guess you could say energetic fans that, like, let this flow through them as much as the wrestlers do, and it blows my mind, and it's amazing. Like, those atmospheres are so magical. And, you know, I'm not discriminating anybody of anything within, if you like wrestling or not or anything along those lines, but when you see something phenomenal, you see something phenomenal, and you should always be like, whoa, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's moments for everything, and I feel like within wrestling, anything phenomenal should always be acknowledged and be like, wow, that was amazing wrestling. You should watch this. And then spread the word of, you know, all the amazingness that's going on.
Which is what, you know, we try to do here at Live from the Armory, and tell everybody about great, you know, wrestling that we see. Speaking of great wrestling, talk to us a little bit about your time in Evolve. I know that you managed my BFF, Caleb Conley, and other members of the Premier Athlete brand. So I enjoyed watching you immensely on the Evolve pay-per-views. I did. I got every one. But just, you know, talk to us a little bit about, you know, your time there.
I honestly can't say anything, but it's been one of the coolest and most amazing times of my life within wrestling, because I grew and learned so much, and being around all those people, including staff and talent and you know, people that were just running errands or like just doing whatever. It was very, very, very influential and very inspiring to be around like so many great talents and undiscovered talents that people, you know, wouldn't even know about because for the general consensus of what the world is, you know, WWE is wrestling. And
right.
within independent wrestling, it's been growing more and more and more. You know, I highly do believe Evolve is a big, big company. But at the same time, it's like, you know, these guys are putting their bodies on the line, doing some of the most insane things I've ever seen in my life, and just living for the dream. And it's like, this should be on TV. This should be, you know.
Exactly.
This should be somewhere where people, everybody can see this because it's not really about the, you know, the product that they're putting on. It's more about the magic they're producing for people to see. And it's really, really cool. I mean, I can't even explain watching AirPods die from a balcony or, you know, Rich and Ricochet tagging up, how magical that is. Or like watching like Uha Nation do Uha Combo, or like Tozawa doing his, you know,
right.
Everybody just screams right back, and it's so empowering and magical. Or like if you want to go deeper into it, Anthony Nese, Caleb Conley, Trent Acid, Trent Beretta.
Right.
I say Trent Acid because I feud them on N64. I'm sorry, I didn't mean. And then Mr. A and me, like all in the ring. When they cut the promo, like it, and you know what promo I'm talking about, and I'm not gonna refer to which one because if you really want to look, you're gonna go find it yourself. There's a promo that Anthony and me used and everybody in the ring cuts, and it's like, whoa, and it's back and forth and with two different groups, which led into like one of the coolest like matches I've ever seen in my life at the Lyceum building, and I call that the Fight Club building because it reminds
right.
me of like Fight Club because you're like, oh, don't talk about it. We don't, you know what I mean?
First rule.
Yeah, first rule, we don't talk about it. But like that match with that promo, that whole night was so magical. Like I can't even explain how much that night meant to my career just because of it felt like legitimately the thing that I could have ever felt to ECW. And that's something that I have looked at like, whoa, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is so cool. Now that I'm with WSU and CZW, you know what I'm saying? Now it's a different ballgame. But,
right.
like, that feeling within that time frame, like, that was like, whoa, that was so fucking cool. So fucking crazy. How do I need to censor myself? This is so not good.
It's all good.
Just because this is the way I naturally talk, and it's just, I'm sorry.
Right.
I apologize to all the fans that are offended, or people that are listening that are offended. I promise. No offense.
No worries.
You know, no worries. No worries at all. I was recently asked this question, so I'm going to ask it of you.
So,
who do you think will be the first two women to main event at WrestleMania?
You know, I really feel like there's an inkling in my stomach that there's something that's going to happen between Stephanie McMahon and Ronda Rousey. And this is just me fantasy booking in my head. I don't know anything at all, and I'm disclaimering right now. Like, I have no idea about anything. I don't ask about anything. I kind of live in my own world.
Right.
Just to be fair. Sure. But in my own world, I'd see Stephanie McMahon versus Ronda Rousey, and it'd be a team. It would be either, like an even amount of team on either side, and then they'd go in. Eventually, you know, having it come to two girls that are going to lead into, and I'm sorry to say it like this, no one thinks I'm like crazy or anything, but this is just my booking idea, not a clairvoyance thing. They're going to lead two girls into this that will lead it basically the new Trish and Lita kind of ideal.
Right.
And
lead the story within Ronda and Stephanie McMahon into something really, really dynamic within pop culture. That's my prediction.
Right, because, you know, Ronda comes out with the Dragon Ball Z shirts.
And who else would be awesome with Dragon Ball Z? Bailey, because she's friends with New Day. Boom.
Oh, yes.
Boom. And then guess what? They're hugging everybody in there. Bailey to
yes.
Bailey. Bailey to Belly. Boom. Everybody. And then Ronda Rousey. Bailey to Belly's Bailey. She Bailey to Belly's her. And they're friends forever.
I like your booking. I like it a lot. You know, Kevin Owens was berated by some for his interaction with a fan this past weekend. I'm just curious, what's your opinion on what happened with that young wrestling fan?
That's what I have to say about that. How are you going to be mad about that? But then, like, no one gives a, you know what, about Vince McMahon blowing up in a limo. I'm not trying to, like, bring it up, like, bad past
right.
anything, but it's kind of like, you guys are, like, you guys complain, but then you guys get upset because, you know, it's kind of like you guys are never happy, so.
Right.
I guess you guys are just, you know, sadistic. I don't know. I don't know what to say about that. Sadistic fans, they just like it. Give it to them. Give it to them. Give it to them. If you like
that's
it, like it. Go ahead. If that's what makes you happy and that's what you want, go ahead. I want you to be happy. Your happiness means more than my happiness because guess what? I'm getting punched in the face for you to be smiling.
Right.
My whole thought,
we're all wrestling in our underwear and we're getting punched in the face for you guys to be smiling. What more do you want? You guys complain too much. Just be happy with what you got.
Exactly.
Because guess what? You ain't doing it. We doing it for you. And we're doing it for us because we're also sadistic in a way. But I'm not going down that road right now. We're not going to talk about that.
That's another podcast, right?
That's
yeah,
for
exactly.
the next podcast.
Oh, Lord. My whole thought on it was just simply, what did you think or what did you expect was going to happen?
Exactly.
I mean, let's just stop for a second. You know, he wasn't pushing an ice cream cart. I mean, that's just the way it is. So I wanted to.
What?
Yeah.
I don't push no ice cream carts. Who does that? Can I do that now?
I don't
okay
know. The repo man used to repo cars and he wrestled. I mean,
oh,
you know.
Did he pay for that too? Because that's a great deal right now. I am, I'm looking at my, I can go repo some cars right now. Right now.
I used to repo cars. We'll just hop in the car. We'll go repo some cars.
Oh, man, you better have a gun on you because no one trusts me with a gun, so just be honest.
We'll take that at face value. That's a poor lead-in to my next question because I
yes.
wanted to talk to you a little
you
bit.
See,
about...
Wait, I'm just going to say this. If you see me pop out of a repo car and I do not have a gun on me, you better be worried because you don't know what I'm going to do next.
Especially if you're
lucky enough
to have
a gun and not me, because
with the whole makeup and everything, you pop out with
a
gun.
Lord. Mm. Oh, God.
That'd be the best repo company ever. Hello? No one would be late on their
exactly.
payments. They'd be like,
might
no.
be late. They're going to send Sue out.
Yeah, they're like, don't make it 6-2 on you. We don't do it. And they're like, no.
Oh,
here
my God.
Is the payment. Or here's all the rest of the payments.
Yeah.
That's how much it would be.
Here's my payment book in one check. I'm just giving it
yeah.
to you all right now. Sounds fair.
Yeah.
I wanted to talk to you briefly, Sue, about relationships for a moment. Not any specifics, but just in general terms. It's been said in wrestling that if you come out with one or two good friends, you're considered extremely lucky. Why is that? And what has been your experience with that so far?
I think that people say that because this business is very treacherous and
very crazy at times, in the negative, of course. There's way more positive than negative. If you jump in the negative, then you're going to be, like, in a little rabbit hole for a little bit, you know what I'm saying? But as far as, like, how criticizing this business can be for what we do and, you know, what we sacrifice, it's very crazy compared to, like, what other people would consider, you know, the realms of reality, I guess you can say. And the reason why all of us wrestlers do is because we're kind of crazy and we all have a weird tick in our head that makes us be like, no, this is great. This is awesome. And most people that are of the normal realm wouldn't understand that because it is a very, you know, different ideal they have, I guess you can say. But
that makes sense. That makes sense to me.
Yeah.
What do you think?
How you look at it, I guess you can say, like, where it comes down the lines to.
Right. So what do you think is the biggest misconception about you?
I don't speak English. Really? Yes.
Seriously?
Or if I know how to talk, or if I know English, it kind of baffles me. I'm like, what? And they're like, no, you. I'm like, oh, okay. That's why I was like kind of debating on doing this or not, because I'm like, do they want to know if I know English, or do they want to know if I speak? So it's kind of like, well, you know, when I'm talking to you guys, it reminds me of talking to Jessica James, because me and her have the exact conversations about this kind of stuff. I love her to death. Shout out to JJ. Love you, boo.
So people honestly don't think that you have a command of the English language?
For the beginning of my career, the misconception was I did not know English. And it was kind of weird because promoters would be talking to me in broken English, and I wouldn't understand why until my trainer was looking at me like, you know, give me the little wink, like, they don't know you know English. And I'm like, oh, why?
That's
that was
a great question.
Question in
why?
My head was, why? Yeah, that was always the first question in my head. Why? Why don't they know this? And it's like, oh, yeah, I'm in this certain area where this knowledge is not known.
Right.
And then took me to Dungeons and Dragons times where I was like, oh, man, I can use this to my advantage. And sometimes, sometimes it would, sometimes it wouldn't. But never, ever to harm or, you know, put anybody out of any kind of deposition, of course.
That's crazy to me. But
I
guess in the realm of craziness, that's moderate crazy, I guess. Well, for fans that want to come up and find out that you actually can speak English, where are you going to be at coming up so that they can come out and see you, Sue, and talk to you, and you can talk back to them?
Well, I don't really talk much, so good luck with that. But
okay.
This is probably like the most I talk in public or towards, like, people, unless you met me in person and talked to me, because that's most likely the only way I will talk to you like this. But as far as, you know, where you can find me on social media, it's under Real Sü Yüng on almost everything except for Twitter and Facebook. So, yeah, your only options are Twitter and Facebook. My bad.
Okay, no, that's cool. Merchandise, if people want to get a hold of Sü Yüng merchandise, how do they do that?
Oh, yeah, pro wrestling tees, and I sell stuff live. Oh, and the next show I'm going to be at is Shine.
Okay.
In Ybor, live.
Okay. Right.
On the new thing, Fight Sports. Sports.
On the new what?
The new thing. What's the new thing? Everybody's doing it. Well, not everybody's doing it, actually. WWE Live is doing it first.
Flow Sports.
Fight Sports. Sports
Flow Sports. Flow Slam.
Look, we're doing this like we don't even know.
Yeah.
What is it called? Flow Slams?
Flow Slam.
This is new. So I'm learning
as
we're going right now.
The
something new every day.
Yeah.
Every day. Learning something new. Flow Slam. Yeah.
That's the thing.
That's where it'll
that's
be.
The new thing right now. Clotheslines is really cool.
There you go.
Well.
the last thing that we ask all of our guests to do, Sue, if you would be so kind as to record an audio bump, if you could say something like, "This is Sue Yüng, and you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show," that would be great. And you could go when you'd like.
Is this like live?
Yeah, we're live now.
And then we're recording this live.
We're live.
And we're going up on iTunes probably in the next hour, Stitcher in the next hour. It'll be streamed.
iTunes, shout out.
Yeah, streamed overseas by FNX Network. You'll be in Australia, Japan, and all that by morning's light.
Oh, snap. Boy, mate, no, that's not even Australian. My bad. Oh, I just turned off all your Australian people. I'm sorry. only Americans will laugh right now because we're jerks. We're big old jerks. This is true. This is true.
American, yeah.
Big old America. That's probably what they think we sound like when we say hello.
Well, America. Here we are.
Good old America.
America.
So one more time.
So we go just like.
So I get this perfect
just,
for everybody. What do you want me to say?
We go like, "This is Sü Yüng, and you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show."
All right. I think I'm ready. This is Sü Yüng, and you're listening live from the Armory Show.
Cool. Thank you, Sue. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, and this was really fun. Thanks, guys, for having me. I'm probably not going to do this again for a while, so.
Well, we appreciate you coming on when you did. We had a blast.
Absolutely. Yeah, thank you so much. We appreciate it, too.
What if I was like, "Actually, guys, I'm not Sü Yüng," and you guys are talking to somebody who's, like, not real right now?
Well, that's kind of what we thought.
Yes.
I mean, when the conversation...
You guys will see that shows, and if I'm real, I'm real. If I'm not... Oh no. Oh no.
Oh my gosh. Sue, you have a great night. Have a great holiday. Happy New Year. All that junk. Take care, okay?
Thank you so much.
Hey, you guys.
Sue.
Hell yeah.
All right.
No, I wasn't supposed to. You guys know I wasn't supposed to say that. Happy holidays, you guys.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays. And I'll see you guys, if not at Shine, on the network where you can watch it live, or on social media where you can wish me happy holidays always, or if anything, you know, I'll see you down the road somewhere, I guess, next year.
I'm sure.
Something.
Queen to Combat.
My title.
Yes, your title.
My title.
Yes, the title.
Is Papa Hale going to be there? I hope so.
I hope so too.
Is that bad? I'm like, Papa Hale? No? Oh.
No.
He's like the coolest guy ever. Legit. And I love Ben Martin too. He's always sweet. And Juan. Damn it. Like, there's so many cool people. So many. And
there's so little time, right?
Anytime anyone can let me slap a taco in their face, I'm down.
I'll keep that in mind.
Yeah, exactly.
When people bring tacos to the shows, I just want to slap people with tacos. Sometimes it gets wild. Tonga almost got a bunch of meat in his face one time when I slapped Dominique Fabiano with a taco in her face. It was crazy because he was, like, way across the room where people were selling their pictures and stuff. It got bad because it got on some of the girls' stuff. I didn't mean it. It's just a little taco meat and cheese and lettuce. Fine.
There you go.
I think the worst thing about that, and this was a girls' fight, worst thing about that was a brand new ring, so they're quite pissed off.
Oh, I bet.
I did not mean it either. I didn't know it was a brand new ring. I was like, oh, no. Oh, no. Tacos are so good, though. We ate tacos after I slapped people with them.
Sü Yüng. The Sü Yüng story.
Yeah, the slapper of tacos.
Taco slapper.
There you go. New chant. New hashtag trending. Taco slapper.
Well, that sounds okay. This could really be bad, though. Like, looking at the hashtag, like,
that's
other people
just think it was
like,
something
children,
else.
Children, do not look up this. Children, this is like definitely R rated. And I'm not saying what I'm doing is R rated, but in a way, it could be because some people could be offended. So I'm sorry, but
We'll have to put out like a disclaimer. Sü Yüng says, do not Google taco slapper.
Don't do it. Just don't.
Do it, but just don't.
But just, yeah.
Don't do it. Just don't do it. It's a really bad idea. You could probably not sleep for like a week.
Probably
not. I don't even want to know. Sue, thank
don't
you so
look
much.
It up. It's the holidays, guys. Come on, be better than that. Be better
That's
than
true.
That. Don't look it up.
Thank you, Sue.
Yes, thank you so much, Sue.
I feel like I'm like a 90s like dare commercial. Don't do it.
or dare. Don't do drugs. Don't do it.
Don't do drugs and don't look up taco slaps.
My God, we're going to get thrown off the air.
That's all right. Ow, this, we're not saying anything at all bad.
No, that's true.
And we were just saying goodbye. I'm sorry,
right.
I didn't mean to prolong this conversation. My bad.
That's okay. That's okay. Hey, no problem.
Probably dipping into like some conversations about Kevin Owens beating somebody up. My bad.
Hey, no problem, Sue. Thank you again. We appreciate you. You have a good night.
Yes. Thanks,
no, thank you, guys. And I'll talk to you guys at the next show.
Yes, you will.
All right. Have a good
night. Peace out. Happy holidays.
All right.
Happy holidays.
Bye.
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 And there goes Sü Yüng. Oh, my God. Freaking believable.
That was a great interview. That might have been our best one yet, Bob.
Folks, we covered it all. Everything from peanut butter to
taco
slapper. Where else will you hear anything like that except on Live from the Armory Wrestling Show? Folks, as you know, this is our final live broadcast of 2016. Watch Twitter, watch Facebook. We will post up a couple episodes. Next week, we're going to post up a very special episode that involves myself, Laura, and George. Pro Wrestling Secrets Revealed. You don't want to miss that. That's a tell-all. And that is a shoot. So you're going to have to check that out. It is a shoot. You're going to have to check that out. Laura, your final thoughts, comments on 2016?
It was a tough year. It really was in a lot of ways. It was a great year, a wonderful year in a lot of ways. But we had some great guests. We had a great time. And that's just the most important thing is that you and I have a good time doing this. And thanks to everybody who calls in and who listens and who participates in the show by being a guest. We really, truly appreciate it. And thank you so much to Sü Yüng for coming on. And I don't think I've laughed that hard in a very long time. What a wonderful person. And I love the fact that she thought most things about wrestling were magical. And I think if more people looked at wrestling that way, they would enjoy it more.
I would agree with that statement 100%. The power of positivity. And we'll roll the power of positivity back on the airwaves live. We'll return January 18th, 2017 for season number 3 of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. Obviously, want to thank everybody involved with the program. Want to thank Sü Yüng for being on, from both Laura and myself. We'd like to wish you a very Merry Christmas. We'd like to wish you a Happy New Year. Be safe, be well, and we'll see you January 18th, 2017. Folks, thank you for listening tonight, and remember, there is never a bad taco. I mean, there is never a bad seat here at the Armory. We'll catch you soon, folks. Good night.
Taco slapper.
Have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Radio Show. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. And you can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
Attention outlet shoppers, right now, save 50 to 70% off everything for the family at Gap Factory stores and online, with shorts from $14.99 and tees from $6.99. And save 50 to 70% off everything at Banana Republic Factory stores and online, with an extra 50% off clearance and dresses for women starting at $19.99. Hurry! Search our store locator for your nearest Gap Factory and Banana Republic Factory store, or shop us online. Attention outlet shoppers, right now, save 50 to 70% off everything for the family at Gap Factory stores and online, with shorts from $14.99 and tees from $6.99. And save 50 to 70% off everything at Banana Republic Factory stores and online, with an extra 50% off clearance and dresses for women starting at $19.99. Hurry! Search our store locator for your nearest Gap Factory and Banana Republic Factory store, or shop us online.